Harper Audio presents The Dilbert Principle by Scott Adams. These days, it seems like any idiot with a laptop computer can churn out a business book and make a few bucks. That's certainly what I'm hoping. It would be a real letdown if the trend changed before this masterpiece comes out. As some of you may know, my main profession is cartooning. Cartoonists are trained to be brief. Everything I've learned in my entire life can be boiled down to a dozen bullet points, several of which I've already forgotten. You'd feel kind of perturbed if all you heard were a dozen bullet points, particularly if several of them seemed to be filler. So my plan for excellence is to repeat myself often to take up time. In marketing terms, this is called adding value. If you've worked in the business world for more than 10 minutes, you know it's an immense exercise in the absurd. Yet somehow, amazingly, the economy still hums along. Most of the themes in my comic strip, Dilbert, involve workplace situations. I routinely include bizarre and unworldly elements such as sadistic talking animals, troll-like accountants, and employees turning into dish rags after the life force has been drained from their bodies. And yet the comment I hear most often is, "That's just like my company." No matter how absurd I try to make the comic strip, I can't stay ahead of what people are experiencing in their own workplaces. Some examples. A major technology company simultaneously rolled out two new programs. First, a random drug testing program. And second, an individual dignity enhancement program. Example number two. A company purchases laptop computers for employees to use while traveling. Fearing they might be stolen, the managers come up with a clever solution. Permanently attach the laptop computers to the employees' desks. Or how about this? A freight company reorganized to define roles and clarify goals. Management decides to communicate the changes by ordering each department to build floats for a quality parade. And lastly, a company decides that instead of raises, it will give bonuses if 5 of 7 company goals are met. At the end of the year, employees are informed that they have met 4 of 7 goals, so no bonuses. One of the goals they missed was employee morale. Thousands of people have told me workplace stories, mostly through email, that are even more absurd than the examples I've given. When I first started hearing these stories, I was puzzled. But after careful analysis, I have developed a sophisticated theory to explain the existence of this bizarre workplace behavior. People are idiots. Including me. Everyone is an idiot, not just the people with low SAT scores. The only difference among us is that we're idiots about different things at different times. No matter how smart you are, you spend much of your day being an idiot. That's the central premise of this scholarly work. I proudly include myself in the idiot category. Idiocy in the modern age isn't an all-encompassing 24-hour situation for most people. It's a condition that everybody slips into many times a day. Life is just too complicated to be smart all the time. The other day, I brought my pager to the repair center because it wouldn't work after I changed the battery. The repairman took the pager out of my hand, flipped open the battery door, turned the battery around, and handed the now-functional pager back to me in one well-practiced motion. This took much of the joy out of my righteous indignation over the quality of their product. Having admitted that I can't replace the battery in my pager, you might wonder what makes me think I'm qualified to make this important tape. I think you'll be impressed at my depth of experience and accomplishment. Number one, I convinced a company to put out this tape and publish my book. That may not seem like much to you, but it's more than you did today. And it wasn't easy. I had to have lunch with people I didn't even know. Number two, I worked in a cubicle for 17 years. Most business books are written by consultants and professors who haven't spent much time in a cubicle. That's like writing a first-hand account of the Donner Party based on the fact that you've eaten beef jerky. Me, I've gnawed on an ankle or two. Number three, I'm a trained hypnotist. Years ago, I took a class on how to hypnotize people. As a byproduct of this training, I learned people are mindless, irrational, easy, manipulated dolts. I think I paid $500 to learn that. And it's not just the so-called good subjects. It's everybody. It's how our brains are wired. You make up your mind first, and then you rationalize it second. But because of the odd mapping of our perceptions, you're convinced beyond a doubt that your decisions are based on reason. They aren't. Important scientists have done studies proving that the area of the brain responsible for rational thought doesn't even activate until after you do something. They were important scientists, but not so important that I remember their names or that you'd care, but I'm sure it's true because I read it in a magazine. You can confirm the fact using hypnosis by giving a person an irrational post-hypnotic suggestion and asking later why the subject did what he did. He will insist it made sense at the time, employing a logic more tortured than Pavarotti at a Tiny Tim concert. A hypnotist quickly develops a complete distrust for the connection between a person's reasons and their actions. It fundamentally changed the way I look at the world. Number 4. Nobody believes statistics anyway. This is a huge time saver for me. It removes any guilt I might have about fabricating statistics. If you're a normal person, you tend to believe any studies that support your current views and ignore everything else. Therefore, any reference I might make to legitimate research is wasted. If we can agree on the futility of trying to sway you with legitimate research, it will save us both a lot of trouble. That doesn't mean I will ignore statistics. Far from it. Throughout this tape, I will make references to scientific studies. Of course, they'll all be total fabrications. If you think about it, most of the studies you see are either completely misleading or intentionally biased. This tape is no different, except that I don't underestimate your intelligence. How could I? Why is business so absurd? I don't know why the economy works, but I'm sure it isn't because brilliant people are managing it. My guess is that if you sum up all the absurd activities of management, the idiocies somehow cancel out, thus producing cool things that you want to buy, such as Nerf balls and Snapple. Add the law of supply and demand to the mix, and you've pretty much described the theory of economics. 90% of all new business ventures fail. Apparently, 10% of the time, you get lucky, and that's enough to support the modern economy. I'm betting that's what separates us from the animals. Animals are only lucky 9% of the time. I suspect this is true because I play strip poker with my cats, and they rarely win. In fact, it's gotten to the point where they run like cowards at the sound of my electric shaver. I think it's important to understand the philosophy of an author before listening to his opinions. That's why I'm telling you this now. The world has become so complicated that we're all bluffing our way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.